Thank you. We remember those times and those things that we have done of which we are not proud. Those things that separate us from ourselves, from each other, and from God. And we call those now to mind, asking God's forgiveness. Lord Jesus, you have shown us the way to the Father. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you have given us the consolation of the truth. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the Good Shepherd, leading us into everlasting life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins and restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Maker and Redeemer, grant us with Charles and all the faithful departed the sure benefits of your Son's saving passion and glorious resurrection, that in the last day, when you gather up all things in Christ, we may with them enjoy the fullness of your promises. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please do sit. We will now have a number of tributes for Charles, from his sons, his grandchildren, his great-grandchildren, and his lodge.
Father has been there for each of us from the moment we were born. All throughout our young days, we never wanted for anything because he prepared us in raising a family of five boys. He took on a task that many would deem possible. Our Father was successful in his efforts. And we stand here today, strong, as he would have wanted. It was his vision, care and love for us that enabled us to stand here strong today. His courage enabled us to stand here strong today. His courage made us feel safe and secure in the land that was not our own. His pride made us confident that we were able to carve out our own path in nurturing guidance. He directed us away from any pain and disappointment which he may have experienced. For this, we are grateful. If not for our Father, his lifelong union with our late mother, none of us would truly be able to stand here and say we would be men, the men we are today. Even in his final days, his many worries were about the generations of people. He gave us instructions on how we should conduct, protect ourselves, and do things for each other. And by his instructions, we would move forward. He was giving and generous, a very generous man, not only to his family, but to all his loved ones and friends. If he knew he had guests coming to the house, he always made sure there was food and drinks and gifts waiting for them. He kept the house presentable at all times, and was always welcoming to people to come and spend time with him. He was very hospitable. Often when people would visit him, he talked about politics. Arsenal, his favourite football team, also about Bannerman here and abroad. He truly loved life and catered for those around him in his own very special way. This love was felt, I'm sure all the members of the panel would agree. This love was felt in the home he built for us, his family. Our father loved to socialize. People loved to see him. He was always dressed to the nines. Anyone who knew him knew he was a dapper dresser. He would often venture out to parties and events with his closest friends, always remaining charismatic and full of decorum. To have a man like this leading us, we were truly blessed and spoiled. Losing Dad and left a huge void in our lives. Many who are attending here today are full. Feel very much the same. The huge void in Dad that only can be filled by the everlasting memory of pure joy.
Keen eye for detail. He wanted every task, no matter how big or small, to be done properly. It was very normal for us all, for all of us grandchildren, to spend our weekends at, and the majority of our summers at our grandparents' house, and we used to love it. Our granddad was so very hardworking. Despite working nights during our youth, he was still present with us during the day. When someone you love passes away, it's funny the little details you begin to remember about them. Grandad loved going shopping, especially for food. I have memories of Grandad who would go for food shopping, and when he returned, all of the grandchildren would create a production line of hands, passing all the wonderful treats he had bought for us to the car, from the car to the kitchen. The kitchen, the centre of our grandparents' house, which became our mini tuck shop. The kitchen where our grandmother would be sat, ready to receive the food that Grandad had bought and continue to cook even more of a feast than she already had prepared for us. I'm sure many of those in church today have come across Grandad in a social capacity in some way, so you will know that our Grandad absolutely loved going out, spending time and enjoying it. Our granddad's love for life is instilled in each one of his grandchildren. The ability to be social while remaining reserved and outspoken and tactful, confident, were many of the life skills that many would find difficult to maintain, yet our granddad had all of them. For granddad, family always came first. Granddad held his grandchildren in high esteem, putting us first as though we were his own children. Once I had a discussion with Brendan about how wonderful and unique our family was to have so many cultures blended into one. Brendan responded with, "Love is love. I will never get in the way of that." That's because my granddad's love for life and family was paramount and always came first. There is no way we could finish this tribute without our grandfather, without mentioning our grandmother. Our grandfather and grandmother were different, yet wonderfully compatible. Our grandmother understood our grandfather like nobody else, and vice versa. They would laugh and sometimes bicker, but it would always end in a peaceful result. And they would just carry on as normal as though nothing had happened. I always used to wonder if our grandma just knew what my grandma wanted without them saying a word. But as I've grown up and entered into marriage myself, I realised that this comes from knowing the person inside out, and it's beautiful to watch.
And now we have our tribute from Charles's Lodge.
Good morning, family and friends. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall be no more death, no more sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. The former things are passed away. Revelations 21, verse 4. Our distinguished and worthy brother Charles James Luke Bannerman was a kind, charitable, and affable gentleman of few words. Those sterling qualities played an important part in advancing his search of Masonic light and truth. And the consequent sharing of the good report about him opened the way for his initiation into the fraternity of ancient Freemasonry by the Red Triangle Lodge number 4000 on the 6th of May 1998 at Freemasons Hall, Great Queen Street, London, WC2. Once admitted, he diligently demonstrated his desire for further knowledge and the pursuit of the spiritual, moral, and social virtues, which are the mainstays of Freemasonry, by extending his researches in the direction of a lodge the province of Middlesex. And it was there that his burgeoning Masonic talents and skills were honed to the the delight of both his mother Lodge, London Lodge, and surrogate Middlesex Lodges. Within a short period, Brother Bannerman gained a large following of admiring brethren who often invited him to participate in their meetings so as to enjoy his hallmark, flawless rendition of Masonic narrative ritual. Such was the measure of the affection and admiration brethren had for our dear senior brother of departed merit. It was therefore no surprise when it pleased the provincial Grand Master of Middlesex to confer two honors of past provincial assistant grand director of ceremonies and past provincial grand standard bearer of our, to our brother. By these testaments, we are able to say of our late Westville brother Charles James Luke Bannerman with justified pride that he rose to Masonic eminence by merit. He lived, respected, and died, regretted. We already miss your warm smile, brother, but we shall never forget you. We thank our Maker for the gift of your life and companionship. Rest in peace till we meet again. Anyaminupa, Yawoduba. Thank you.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to it myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, you do not know where you are going. How can you know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The gospel passage we've just heard from is very near the end of the Gospel of St. John. Jesus, knowing that his persecution and death is drawing near, is trying to prepare his friends for what he knows will come next. His friends are, as anyone would be faced with losing somebody they love, they are confused, they are distressed, and they are in denial. We come into this passage as he is comforting them. And part of his comfort to them is that he promises them that he will not abandon them, that he will prepare a place for them with his Father where he soon will be. The words that John uses for place in this passage mean somewhere to abide, to inhabit, somewhere that we can feel fully at home. And neither his disciples nor we should be surprised at this, because Jesus Christ in his very person is God dwelling with us, coming to us, abiding with us. All those things that separate us from God are, in the person of Jesus, swept away. Right at the beginning of this same gospel, St. John writes, "The Word became flesh and dwelt among us." You might be familiar from that from countless carol services, but a better translation would be, "The Word became flesh and pitched his tent among us." God in Jesus comes to us all and pitches his tent in the midst of us, to abide with us in all of our joys and all of our sorrows. And because of his own death and resurrection, to abide with each of us in and through and beyond our own deaths. Charles knew what it meant to abide. He knew the value of finding a place and dwelling profoundly with the people there. And I think we've heard some of that from the tributes that have been given so far, and from further tributes in your orders of service. Charles pitched his tent in the midst of his family, his friends, and his community, and he was known and loved as someone who was committed to a place and its people. This kind of life, the kind of life that Charles led, centers around a decision to abide and to inhabit, And this is significant, not because it gives the person who is abiding something wonderful, though it does, but it's much more generous than that. It's significant because through one person's commitment to a place, to a family, and to people, others are enabled to feel truly at home, and thus to be able to flourish, to find out who they are, to find their place and their own growth. What a wonderful gift Charles has left you all with. In the midst of grief, we can feel unmoored, that with the death of someone significant, all our compass points are obscured. It's the very opposite of feeling as though we are abiding in a comfortable, known place. To his friends who were feeling this, Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled." So I say to you, do not let your hearts be troubled, because Christ abides with us in this life, encouraging us all to follow his example and to follow the example of people we have around us, like Charles, to pitch our tent in the midst of other people. And Christ abides with us as we pass through death, ready to welcome us home, where we will abide with him as Charles now does. Amen.
In your image to reflect your truth and light. We give you thanks for Charles, for the grace and mercy he received from you, for all that was good in his life, for the memories we treasure today. Especially we thank you for his care of his family, his friendship, and for all of his activities with and for his community. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, Father of all mercies and giver of all comfort, your mighty power brings joy out of grief and life out of death. Deal graciously, we pray, with those who mourn, particularly Charles and Esther's children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, that they may cast their cares on you, so that they may know the consolation of your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As you are able, please do stand to share God's peace. Jesus says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and neither let them be afraid. The peace of the Lord be always with you."
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Oh Lord, my God, when I am also souls. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, gracious Lord, creator of heaven and earth, giver of life and conqueror of death. By his death on the cross, your Son, Jesus Christ, offered the one true sacrifice for sin, breaking the power of evil and putting death to flight. Through his resurrection from the dead, you have given us new birth into a living hope, into an inheritance which is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. The joy of the resurrection fills the universe, and so we join with angels and archangels, with Charles and all your faithful people, evermore praising you and saying, saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and your name for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Remember your servant Charles, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he, who was united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, the God-bearer, the apostles, the martyrs, and all the saints, may we praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom, and with whom, and in you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever Behold Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his Son.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but I will only say a word, and shall be healed.
Okay.